Devrup, you're not audible. You're on mute.
Sorry, I was speaking on mute. So good afternoon and a warm welcome to all our panel members today and members of the audience. Today, as part of the ASSOCHAM Startup Launchpad series, we are here to discuss on a very important and critical subject, which is on the proof of concept for startups. How important, how critical is a proof of concept for startups? As part of our guests, we have senior leadership from government. We have people, senior leadership from academia, from the industry, to talk about this subject, to develop on the importance of proof of concept for startups and see what sort of help support our startups, which are a critical part of driving the growth of the Indian economy, can get in terms of delivering proof of concepts. So with this, I'll call upon Mr. Rohit Bhayana, who is the chairperson for ASSOCHAM Startup Council, to address the audience with his welcome address. Over to you, Rohit.
Thanks, Evru. A very good afternoon to everyone, and welcome to the session. On behalf of Neelam Dhawan, my co-chair, and I, it's a pleasure to be here on the fourth roundtable discussion. Devrup, thanks for moderating. You were there last time with us, and it was wonderful. So I'm glad you could make time again. POCs have emerged amongst the top five areas when we polled startups about a month and a half ago. They stood pretty much as high on priority as funding, marketing, incubators. So I'm glad we could pull it as far ahead because I think all of us understand how vital in a startup environment POCs can get to be. That's really the time when you declare yourself, you've come of age. So POCs are fairly well understood in concept, but in execution, it makes all the difference. And that is where today's panel, in my mind, brings experts to get into the details. Let's really understand from people who are mentoring POCs, who are part of having been through several POCs. So I'm very glad we could have this August panel together. Personally, I've seen several startups leverage POCs and make the most of it as a watershed time in their evolution journey. It's a time when, on the back of a successful POC, they decide to expand the team, they decide to approach investors, they decide to announce their arrival to competitors and clients. So beyond doubt, a very, very crucial moment in the evolution. Now, how the POCs play out, and we're going to look forward to this panel today, but how POCs play out in my mind can be from things which are very much internally oriented and tuning the product, from getting a real data environment and therefore getting more solid with your models and more solid with your algorithms, to validating your ROIs for the clients. So from a very inward leverage to a very outward leverage, and everything in between, which basically goes to saying that it's something which we had to bring on into the session. So Devrup, dear panelists, pleasure to be here with all of you, and let's get this going.
Thanks, Rohit, for your initial address, initial words. So with this, we move on to the next part, which is around getting opinions and views of our experts today. Starting off with Dr. Ajay Kumar Garg, who is the Senior Director in Ministry of Electronics and IT, Government of India, to get a view from a government perspective. So we have seen our Honorable Prime Minister time and again talk about his vision of India being a startup hub. And we've also seen a lot of progress in this. We have seen a large number of unicorns coming out this year. Now, being part of government, what role do you see POCs have in driving this vision of India being a startup hub? So over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dharsa, for this. First of all, let me thank ASSOCHAM to make me a part of this very important event. And let me also thank ASSOCHAM for taking an initiative of this getting the large industry connected with the Indian startup ecosystem. It's very heartening to see when the industry champions actually nurture the babies. And Having said this, what I will say that these have paid rich dividends in the last 2, 3 years, in spite of the biggest economic distress that the world economics has seen in the last 2 years or so because of this pandemic. The startup story in India has made a significant progress and actually matured out to now show that what we have done in 75 years since independence will pay rich dividends, and India will be a much deep-rooted economy by 2047 when we become 100 years post-independence. So that's what the startup story, and that's what an industry startup connect significance is in the present perspective. Seeing 17 years, so there was one more unicorn that came yesterday. So seeing 17 unicorns in the last 7 months, moving the target from having 50 unicorns by 2022 to now 75 unicorns by 2022 and 150 unicorns by 2025 shows that the Indian startup ecosystem has moved beyond what is said is a support of the government that is required to nurture the baby or incubate the baby. Now it's a journey of acceleration that is to be there for the next 5, 7 years, so that these startups actually play a significant role in contribution to the Indian economy, play a significant role where innovation becomes the key enabler for growth and becomes a significant contributor for socioeconomic change, where technology actually improves the lives of the people. These are the three key takeaways that the startup ecosystem can bring to the system, and now is the time that they make significant impact on ground, and where the industry or industry bodies like ASSOCHAM will play a key enabling role. Government, through its various policies under the Startup India program or under the Digital India program, whether it's our TIDE program, whether it's our accelerator programs, whether it's the Mighty Startup Hubs, or whether the N number of COEs that we have now played, but they will be a lesser of significance to in coming years, and the industry and the investment will play a much deeper role in the next 5 to 10 years in the startup growth journey, and that's what I believe. And this BOC is a very important platform which enables such an ecosystem for the future. Thank you once more for giving me this opportunity. Look forward to some meaningful discussions. Thank you.
Thanks, sir, for your view on the role of startups in driving the Indian economy as we move forward. So with that, I'll move to Mr. Sachin Tagra, partner, JSW Ventures, to get a view from a VC fund perspective. So Sachin, as a VC fund, when you look at investing in a startup, how important it is to have a POC ready for that startup, or why is that important from a VC funding perspective? So Sachin, over to you.
Sure. Thanks, Devroop. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for having me here. So, Devroop, to your question of why it is important to have a POC and what do VC look for? First, let me start with, what is proof of concept? It is actually first an idea which gets converted into a concept, and then you have to validate that concept. So when I say idea, what founders bring to the table is a problem which he or she is trying to solve, and he develops a product or service which is actually a solution to the problem. So unless you go back to a customer with that solution and validates that, then the business can be achieved at a scale. So when you do go for a validation, the first validation is whether you are genuinely solving a problem or not. That is the first validation, when a consumer is happy with the product or not. The second comes in, how many customers will pay for it if I launch this product, whether it is a scalable idea or not. If customers will pay, what will they pay for it? No, that means the value of the product and the service. and how large that market is. That is how a typical VC looks at the opportunity of a validation of an idea through this process. That means whether a customer is happy with the product and service, how many customers will use the product, and if they pay for it, how many customers will pay for it. So it's a stepwise process for any investor, and I would actually call it even for the founder to go through this cycle or go through this process to understand, because founder is going to put his blood and sweat and his next 5-10 years in this journey. So he needs to validate that. So this is a validation which is not by any external party, but it is a validation by customers and consumers, because he's going to spend time and resources in building this up. It is better to do it at the earliest stage than at a later stage and improve the product in case the product is not, or product has some feedback. Second, I think with the technology startups, the biggest advantage you have is you get a lot of data. Data of every transaction, every engagement which a consumer is doing with the product. So even if consumers are unable to state specifically what their needs or what their wants, or whether they're able to address the solution or not, or have a product which is helping them address their need, you can actually read that data and develop a product which is validated of a sort by customers. So today we have a big advantage of the data flowing back to a business to see the customer response. From a VC perspective, it is important that this proof of concept or a validation or a product market fit, we call it various terminologies, is there, because if you have to scale this up, then you need a viable product before you get into scaling. Although there are options available in the market where there are a lot of incubators, educational institutions, micro VCs, which are ready to fund your concept at an idea stage where it is not yet validated. But it depends on, which VC are you approaching, what stage of the VC, whether it is a seed investor, whether it is a Series A investor, Series B investor. So there are options available in the market for founders to go and get the validation of their product and then raise a funding.
Thanks, Sachin. That was quite interesting and quite useful in the way you defined what is a POC and why it's important and what's the process. So with that, we'll move to Mr. Himanshu Periwal, who is the co-founder of Unloo. So now from a VC, we're moving to a startup itself. So Himanshu, as a startup founder, and as well as someone who has mentored other startups as well, what are the issues or challenges that a startup face when it tries to go for a full-fledged POC at being made ready at the starting phase itself? So Himanshu, over to you.
So I hope you can hear me, right?
Yes, we can.
Right. So a lot of challenges. In fact, I can share some from my own journey, some from a couple of mentees that I've had, right? Let's say, in the beginning stages of a startup, when you are in doing a POC, most likely you have a very, very small team, a very lean team of, let's say, at max 5 people, right? Maybe like 2-3 would be co-founders only. So at that time, resources and having all capabilities. So at times some people have lack of tech resources. If it's a startup by techie, then they have lack of business resources or marketing resources, right? So how a co-founder can make do and act a jack of all trade is very, very important in the POC stage. Second is the need of capital, because when you are doing a POC, you also want to do a lot of experiments, right? And at that time, having capital is probably one of the biggest blockers, where startup founders at one stage decide that okay, this is going to be the last attempt, and a lot of times startup founders give up after that stage, which is again like a big challenge. Lastly, I would say a proper guide. I mean, the reason why I've been mentoring a lot of founders is because I've been through that journey, and I know a lot of such, people, professionals, like people like us in the panel right now, right, who could add so much value to budding founders, people who graduate from college, and that's very important to guide them to the right direction. Because as a founder, you are thinking in all the directions, and at a POC stage, you really need to be guided towards a step-by-step journey as to, okay, the focus of this week should be XYZ things, and to be able to achieve a POC, you know, be very data driven, achieve these results, that is very, very important. So I think these are like top 2-3 challenges that startup founders face, and some of the things that need to be done to help them achieve, you know, the POC success.
Sure. Thanks, Himanshu. That was a very useful and very practical view about what are the issues or challenges that a startup can face. So with that, we'll move on to a view of the academics here. So we have Dr. Satyaranjan Acharya, who is associate professor and in charge of Department of Entrepreneurship Education at the Entrepreneurship Development Institute of India. So Dr. Acharya, what are the ways by which a startup can build and build upon, develop and improve upon their POCs? So over to you, Dr. Acharya.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Okay, thank you. I think the first two, that the comments that we have already talked about on the POC, what is a POC is about and how it should be more customer centric. And Himanshu had also had given that how the support network can be there in the institution. I think these are obviously the valid points at which the POC need to be worked out. I'll again, I'm working with in an academic setup and also working with the other incubation system that we have across India right now we're supporting. And recently I've done a particular study on behalf of one of the government department to understand that what are the type of ideas which has been funded by the various policy initiative, what happened to them? It is purely on an academic setup, and my analysis across India with the majority of the incubator that I have interacted, it shows that most of these ideas the students or the person as an incubatee started up, they are continuing for just as an ideation stage or let's say POC stage, and most of them has dropped their ideas beyond at the level of POC itself. They're not gone beyond POC. So most of the ideas which have been funded, they just try to create a prototype, and then they find out that we cannot go beyond that particular point of time. So I think here, how relevant that the POC that you are designing in terms of how relevant the product is for the market, whether you are actually solving a critical customer problem, and if you are solving a customer problem, is the customer ready to pay a price or not? Can it go to that level or not? I think that needs to be worked out at a very detailed level before going ahead and working out. Otherwise, you may be designing a POC. I think people say funding is a challenge. There are so many funding schemes are available right now in academic setup, and others are available where they can get a funding and can work it out. But when I go through the scholars of funded ideas or the POC stage ideas, there you could find out that nobody, I think 60 to 70% are dying at that stage. They're not going beyond that particular stage. So yes, I think mentoring, the support available, mentoring available from the faculties, or it's the mentoring available from the industry where it could be utilized, or the support or understanding that how it is actually solving a customer problem by validating in the market, validating with the customer. I think these things need to be worked at a very initial stage when they're looking into POC and working on the POC, rather than looking for the completely developing the POC and then find out no taker or no market for that. So at least these are the crux I think they need to concentrate at a very initial level. And there, the role of the incubator and the academic and the industry is very essential. I think the way SHM is going to support, or let's say the most of the incubators right now trying to support, I think if they can work properly, I think we can get so many other POCs actually converted into a product, and maybe at some time they may be converted into a startup.
Thanks, Dr. Acharya, for your view. It's very practical when you spoke about that a POC should be centered around the customer need and whether there's a need for that or not, and it should be done upfront. So with that, we move on to our next guest for the day, Mr. Ramesh Prasad, MD, Economovus Packaging Private Limited. So Mr. Prasad, while we have seen and we talk about many of the tech-oriented startups which focus on the POCs, as a startup company which is focused on innovative industrial packaging solution, what relevance do you see of a POC for companies focused on areas like this, or engineering or packaging or logistics? Do you think a POC is relevant here as well, and how do we go about it? So over to you, Mr. Prasad. Mr. Prasad, you're on mute. Mr. Prasad, can you hear us?
I think he is having some connection issues.
Sure. So maybe we'll come back to him later on. We'll move to the next point. So I'll my next point is to Dr. Dayananda Methi, who is founder and MD of Medilane Health Tech and Consultancy Services Private Limited. So as a successful startup in the Northeast region of the country, we've generally seen startups coming from the southern part, from the western part, etc. So as a successful startup from the Northeast, so how are startups in that region focused on POCs to showcase their idea and solution? Are there resources, etc., available to help drive POCs for startups over there? So over to you, Mr. Meet, Dr. Meet.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes. Yes, you are.
Okay. So thank you. Thank you, Dar. Actually, the in Northeast region, the startups are in the stage like they're just not in the the first stage, like I can say. And most of the startups are now focusing on the POC by applying the Lean Startup. Some of them are applying the Lean Startup model, and we are still need to learn more. We need to more exposure, because most of the startup here in the region is a lack of exposure, because we always think about the very local centric, and we are not cannot see as a market size. Also, we cannot see the market size as an entire country in terms of market size. We always focus on the local level and state level startups only. So when we validate also, when we see the market size also, we only see the market size for the reason. That's why, and when we scaling up, it will be face the challenges. So right now, starting startup are in the stage of early stage, but we need more exposure. But some of the incubation centers like IIM Kolkata, and some of the industry leaders like they're helping, like Assessum also, like we did in the Guwahati, and helping us. And this is what the stage of the North is right now.
Thanks, Dr. Methi. That was a very practical view of challenges that are being faced by startups over there, and what they can do to overcome that. So with that, I'll move to Mr. Satyendra Singh Lilhare, founder of Bastar Se Bazaar Tak, a very different startup. So, Mr. Lilhare, as a startup which is focused on the agriculture sector, and it's aimed at improving livelihood for the tribal population in the country. So how do you view the need of POCs for such a startup to get things moving? Do you think it's relevant for startups in the agri space or in the livelihood space as well? So over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Devrup ji. Aap sabhi ko namaste. Namaste. I'm Satyendra Singh Lilhare, Bastar Se Bazaar Tak, and we are working on post-harvest management of non-timber forest produce based out at North Bastar, Chhattisgarh. And related to this question is very important for our social enterprise, because without proof of concept, no one can hear us, or we can say no one can fund us, any of the angel, or we can say investment or from the bank loan. So that part, proof of concept is very important. So our study that that starts from the tribal farmers in the region, and we started with 15 farmers, and right now we have a 920 smallholder tribal women farmer. So based on that, we learn ki yes, proof of concept ho gaya hai, pilot ho gaya hai, we have some minimum viable product in our hand. But if want to scale, and if want to capture the bigger market in nearby state, or we can see national market, so how we can do and how we can go ahead. So that time proof of concept is very important. And in between that time, this SOCHAM startup launch pad, this is also very important to raise the funding. We raised funds from the US, Seattle, another Tata Group of Investment through IIM CIP. So without proof of concept, there is a, matlab kya bol sakte, uska meaning nahi hai. Wo wahi baat hai ki 10th pass kar liye, if you don't have a degree or diploma, then there is a no job, or there is a no admission in 11th or 12th class, like that in simple. Great, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lilhare, and it was great to hear that POCs are critical and important for even startups in the social segment as well, in the agriculture segment, in livelihood segment. So now I'll come to Rohit, Mr. Rohit Bhayana, Chairperson, ASSOCHAM Startup Council. So Rohit, how does the industry and an investor view the need of POC while gauging the potential of a startup? So how does an investor view the need? How does the industry see this as a need from a startup? Rohit, over to you.
Sure, Devrup. Thanks. By the way, it's just so fascinating to see Satendra Singh Ji on one side, a tribal agri-tech startup, and on the other side, Himanshu, you know, the total other extreme, and how they're thinking of innovation and POCs. So, Devrup, my thought on POCs from a investor viability, and I'll come to investor viability first. I think from an investor viability, it is as important as it is for the industry, but there's an added dimension. When I see at a POC, I'm also getting into the mindset of the entrepreneur, because the POC moment is a moment which, kind of as I was saying in the beginning, becomes a watershed moment. It's given the entrepreneur, the idea originator, like Sachin was saying in the first place, it gives the idea originator the first real moment of truth. It's the first real moment of truth. So forget what are you trying to tell the world. The first thing is what it's trying to tell to you. What is it telling you, not just about your product's functionality, relevance, etc., but also its viability. I've seen a lot of entrepreneurs who just stick with one dimension, which is, okay, my product is ready, but they haven't yet thought through the whole thing. Is my unit economics, is it going to make money? As I scale, will this really play out well? And this becomes a time when you kind of start understanding how they think, how the entrepreneur really thinks. So to me, POCs is the first real brush with reality. It also starts, you know, when you start peeling it, when you start double clicking, triple clicking on it, what it also starts telling you is the originator, is the entrepreneur, are they thinking about what not to do? Because I would assume a POC, as much as it's declared what successfully works, it's also telling what doesn't work, and actually more of what doesn't work. So what not to do? What real problem do you want to solve? So one of the finest POCs, and we ended up investing in this company. One of the finest investment decisions we made was when it is an IoT company, an industrial IoT company we looked at. And when I was in conversation with the founders, the point was that when they enter a manufacturing plant, why they want to deploy their solution to just a cell. So for those of you who come from manufacturing, cell makes up a line makes up a plant, right? So cell is the smallest unit. So typically, a company or an entrepreneur or an idea originator would say, you know what, I want to look at as broad as I get. And these guys got into how narrow can I get? If I fix the cell, the line changes. If I change the line, the plant changes. Now, just localizing yourself to that level of clarity starts becoming extremely meaningful. But the only reason they could get there is because this also understood not only is it about viability, not only is it about the product function, product market fit, it's also about how am I articulating? If I say I'm going to change the whole line and the whole plant, am I creating insecurities in the system? Am I creating a transformation decision? Is now the buyer of this solution not the person I deal with, but somebody who's several levels away, and I won't be able to reach the person, hence my buy decision will be even delayed. So I want to dumb it down. I want to bring, even though I know I can solve the whole line and the whole plant, I want to solve it just for the cell, because the cell's buyer is somebody I deal with every day, and I know I can swing this. And if I swing this, then I can slowly start landing and expanding. I think that mindset becomes very viable there.
Thanks, Rohit. Very interesting point of view. And also, I found it very interesting. You spoke about its POCs also about knowing what does not work. At times, we forget that and focus on only trying to show the concept which is working. So with that, I'll move to Ms. Neelam Dhawan, co-chairperson, ASSOCHAM Startup Council. So Neelam, as a tech industry veteran, and presently you're in role of mentoring various startups or being part of the board of startups, how important or how much importance should a startup give to doing a POC? Is it always mandatory to do a POC?
So, Devrup, thanks for this question. Firstly, I must say that startup or a large company, both go through POCs in our country when they're coming with a new product. It isn't about just startups. So why is this such an important thing? People want to see whether it works in their environment or not. Just like Rohit pointed out, there could be issues with the new product or new technology, which then disrupts how the company works. So most of the companies, especially from technology purposes, create a sandbox, which is nothing but their own environment simulated at a smaller scale. And if somebody comes in and says, I have a new solution, which is for cybersecurity or for AI or whatever, they say, just we want to first test it. Will it work in our environment? And that's when POC becomes very important from the customer's perspective. If it disrupts what they are working, or it has a clash with some other application and they have a lot of modifications to do, needless to say, even if you have the right talent, they will not take it, because they are not wanting to disrupt their existing setups just because there is a new technology come from a startup or from a large company. So POCs is part of life. The problem which I see and which I have experienced myself is you do the same POC repeatedly. I have a product, it's been tested, it is working, but it goes from one company to the other. It may work for X, it's not going to work for me, so do the POC again. And every POC requires money, as has already been said in before, that it requires money. They'll say, show it to me. Second thing happens is the time. Some of the POC, especially in the agricultural sector, take a couple of months. You deploy the new product and it will be 2-3 months before the result comes. Now you're waiting for those 2-3 months for the result to come. Things change, something else goes wrong, weather is not okay. So agriculture really struggles with this concept of POCs and testing before we buy from you. And I think what works in one state doesn't work in another state. That is true even for technology, because anything you deploy in a particular state, it doesn't, the other state wants you to do it again. And hence it makes selling to government very difficult for startups. We are doing POCs, same product, same technology in one state, then we go to the second, then we go to the third. And it takes very long to get returns on this. So POCs are a must, but is there a way to rationalize and reduce? Can people accept that I did this POC in Maharashtra, to work in Delhi? Can people accept that this has worked for company A, will it work for company B? And not say, I am unique. I think that will help a lot. But I cannot see an environment where people will not do POCs. People want to do, and it's a global phenomenon, Devroop. Any new product, any new company coming, bhaiya chala ke dikha do. Whether it's India, whether it's US, they want to see it working. And that challenge is not going to go away.
Thanks, Neelam. Wonderfully said. And as you said, POCs are a must. Probably what is needed is, can something which is working at one place, we directly taking it to the next place instead of having to show it again and again. So I'll come to Mr. Ramesh Prasad. Earlier, I think we had some network issues, so we couldn't get your views. Mr. Ramesh Prasad, MD, Econovus Packaging Private Limited. So Mr. Prasad, we have seen tech-oriented startups which focus on POCs, but as a company which is focused on innovative industrial packaging solutions. So do you see a relevance of POCs for companies which are focusing on sectors such as engineering or packaging or logistics? How relevant, or how do you go about doing a POC in such a case? Over to you, Mr. Ramesh Prasad.
Yeah, am I audible now?
Yes, you are.
Okay. So the answer is definitely yes. The logic and importance of POC remains same, whether it is a tech startup or related to any engineering, logistics or packaging, or for any automobile projects. So on the contrary, I think it is more relevant as stakes and risk are quite high with respect to the investment and time. So during, if I take the example of the automobile project, during the POC, the product and the for any new platform development, the minimum lead time for POC is not just 3-4 months for the concept and the concept validation, but for the testing, it takes 18 whole months. Okay, and you can imagine the risk involved, because for doing the risk involved is around, in any automobile platform, it is around 2000 crores. Okay, and the lead time is 18 months for the validations, for the concept validations. So the POC is really, really important. And in automotive or any manufacturing process, it's very, very important process, and the process-based approach we are following in any manufacturing company, which involves all the stakeholders. In a very defined process, this is a very defined process-based approach as far as the automotive company is concerned. And one more important point here, based on my experience, one need to always onboard one known customer, at least one known customer during the entire phase of POC. This is really going to help us in terms of the product performance, and also to create a foolproof POC.
Thanks, Mr. Prasad. That was a very interesting view. And so we see that for all startups, or as a matter of fact, for any company, irrespective of the sector or the segment, I think there's a need for a POC. There's a need for an early stage realization of the value, getting in customers onboarded, seeing if they're really solving a problem of the customer or not. So we've had one round of discussion with our esteemed panel members. So we'll move on to a little bit of detailing on some of these points which came up. And I would request the views of our panel members, starting with Dr. Ajay Kumar Garg. Sir, you spoke about startups and their importance earlier. So being part of the government.
Mr. Debru, Mr. Ajaykar has just...
Okay, so we'll come back to that point later then. So I'll request Mr. Sachin Tagra to come in. So,
some urgent.
Robinson, your line isn't coming very clear.
Debru, we can't hear you.
Can you repeat the question, please, Debru?
Yeah. So, Sachin, my question was that what would be the best way or means for a startup to look at funding for demonstrating their POC? If a startup wants to look at funding for their POC, what can be the best way or means to go about it?
Demonstrating POC means before the POC, you're saying, or after
POC? Before the POC.
For the POC.
So if someone has a concept and says that, look, I now want to show you the POC. So is there a way by which funding can be available for someone to show a POC?
Yes, I think the environment has now changed significantly in our country in last 4-5 years. Earlier, it used to be a bit difficult. Now with the academia coming in front, government having various sponsored many incubators and accelerators, there are now micro VC funds which are ready to fund businesses at a seed stage. There is a large group of angel networks and individual angels which are again ready to support startups at a concept stage, provided the founder has identified the problem rightly, have created a product or a path to a product which he has an expertise in, and he's the best guy to do it along with his team. I think now these options are very much possible. This was not the scenario a few years ago, but now, if you go out and start reaching out to people, even industries and large industries are also ready to support. You know, we as a JSW group do a lot of these POCs for early stage startups. So now I think the ecosystem has developed significantly for startups to go out and do a POC or raise a small capital for POC. I'm also seeing a trend of now friends and family coming in and pooling the initial capital to develop a product. So one needs to have a good idea and a path to achieve what he intends to do. I think the funding is available in the market.
Thanks, Sachin. That was quite heartening to know, and I'm sure other startups who are listening in would have also noted that. So I'll come to you, Himanshu Periwal. So whenever you've worked in, and you're presently working, you're leading a startup. So how much focus or importance do you as an individual in a leadership position in a startup give to POC in your early days, talking from your experience, Himanshu?
Sure, thanks for the question. No, I feel POC is definitely like the first step. So the first step is, let's say, the idea, right? Idea validation. Then second is understanding your capabilities, resources, capital requirement, drawing, let's say, the plan that whether the idea is scalable or not. And then the next step has to be POC, be it. Right now I'm running my own startup, but let's say even when I was working with Amazon, or the likes of any big companies, right? Any product tech companies, you have to do a POC if you come up with any, big idea, or you have to take a, or do a pilot, right? POC is nothing but like doing a quick pilot to make all the stakeholders believe or get all the stakeholders on the same page that what you're trying to achieve is doable. I think as Rohit mentioned, right? I mean, the unit economics are feasible, things like these, right? And firstly, like the end customer demand is there. Like you are able to speak with relevant customers if you are able to execute a POC, right? A POC doesn't really mean that, you know, you need to have a full-fledged scalable product out there. It can also be part manual, part product-led, but POC is definitely the first step after ideation, documentation, and getting, you know, all the stakeholders together. That is definitely the first step for any startup at any stage.
Sure. Thanks, Himanshu. So now I'll go to Dr. Satyanarayan Satyaranjan Acharya. So Dr. Acharya, as an academician, as a thought leader, as well as someone who's mentoring startups, so at what stage do you recommend POCs for your students, for your mentees, when they're starting on their entrepreneurial journey? So at what point should they start focusing on the POC?
I think in case of, I'll try to divide it two parts. One part for the students part. I think all the students should do this POC as a bit of an experimentation, because that is something which is lacking, that we are not trying to solve any problem in a whole of the academic system that the students are in case of engineering, or let's say various fields, maybe other fields also. So there we are not actually talking to them that go and solve some problem what the company or let's say the market is facing at this point of time. I used to ask the same question to lot many students who are pursuing and studying accounts or something. I say, how many times actually have seen that how the accounts in a company or let's say small and medium enterprise looks like, and what is the type of thing that you are studying in your book? It's same can be for any engineering or let's say any pharma or any student. So if the student is coming out, there is some issue or there is a problem which can be solved, and let's sit together, try to understand what is the problem is, how big is the problem, along with the faculty and the industry expert, let's try to solve it down. I think that process need to be initiated at a very broad level across all the different campuses that we have, the academic campuses. Then we'll be solving large chunk of problem. Out of those problems, some may be good enough to take for the next test, some may not be that big, or that may not be that big as a problem to solve, but the students will have the whole process of looking into a problem and trying to solve it. And that is a problem solving part, they will be testing through the POC stage. I think that is very essential for all of us in our academic systems right now. Rather than just going by the theory and then saying that this is something is going to happen, why can't they go and do this experimentation, whichever the place, whichever the field they have. So I feel in academic, across all different streams in pharma, in terms of medicine, or let's say engineering, and let's say other, the commerce and the science field, if the students start looking into this experimentation by the POC stage, I think we'll get so many different ideas which can be taken to subsequent level. And if there is already a startup which already started interested to work on a particular problem and already identified, obviously he has to do the POC as early as possible so that he can validate the whole concept. And I think his time and others' time and the money that may be invested at a point of time can be saved rather than looking into that time into an idea for a long period of time and then says the thing is there. So as early as we have into an idea, let's try to do a bit of a POC and prove that yes, this is feasible rather than wasting more time on that. So I think this is my suggestions for purely from a negative point of view. How we can take this experimentation of POC to a broad base across many major campuses across academic setup, we can certainly solve a lot many problems that India is facing. Right?
Thanks, Dr. Acharya. So it's a very nice point you put in terms of experimentation with respect to POC at academic campuses and institutes and how students can get in over here and learn from that experience. My next question is to Mr. Ramesh Prasad. So based on your experience of running organizations and running a startup, what are the best practices in implementing POC? So today we have so many startups who are listening into this program. So what are the do's and don'ts or best practices that you would suggest to them?
Various life cycle project, I see POC is extremely, extremely critical and important phase of startup. In POC, we need to focus. Here I would like to mention, we need to focus more on the first phase, which is a defined phase. In defined phase, we must plot a well-documented QFD. QFD is nothing but a quality function deployment. In quality function deployment, we take customer input, understand it correctly, and convert customer voice into a technical specification. Here, the specification has to be defined objectively so that there should not be ambiguity during the validation phase. So again, after the first point, the second, define target quality. Target quality and the must be quality. So the two different objectively measurable specification, we need to define target and must be quality, which is a part of the success criteria. For example, if I take the vehicle ground clearance of 220 mm is a target quality, and 200 mm is a must be quality. This is a certain example I would like to put forth. The second, based on my experience, various startup, okay, tend to miss the testing condition in defined phase, which is very, very important, as the product will behave differently in minus 20 degree and plus 20 degree. So the testing condition has to be defined quite accurately, which will help us for validating the idea and the concept. So lastly, what I said earlier also, the seed customer, we need to identify the seed customer during the development phase so that in every phase they will contribute and give certain suggestion to make the product really foolproof product and to improve the overall product performance.
Sure. Thanks. I wanted to go to Mr. Satyendra Singh Lilhare. So for a startup focused on social development or rural development, etc. So do you think that there is enough focus, enough knowledge drive to do a POC in this space? Is there enough institutional support for POCs in this space?
Great. So in social development, or we can say in rural development, especially in tier 3, tier 4, rural area and geography like Bastar, which is a red corridor area in the country, and especially population like tribal, and in that also women tribal farmers, is too difficult related to the institutional and other things, because we are working in the remote places. In the urban area like block level, or we can say at the district level, yes, of course, there is a facility available, but the distance between that village to particular that Vikas Khand or we can say district is far away here in our region where we are working. So sometime that simple account opening of women entrepreneurial group, it will take 3 to 4 months. सिंपल अगर हमको खाता खोलना है 3 से 4 महीने लग जाते हैं, बिकॉज वी आर इन दी कम्युनिटी स्टार्टअप, एक सोशल स्टार्टअप है, कम्युनिटी स्टार्टअप है, and purely social business hai, that ownership and participation in the hands of the community. So in between this, जैसे बिफोर किसी सर ने कहा है कि प्रोडक्ट मार्केट फिट होता है, साइमल्टेनियसली कम्युनिटी सोशल स्टार्टअप में पर्सन एंड लोकेशन बहुत मायने रखता है. पर्सन एंड लोकेशन फिट होता है, प्रोडक्ट और बाजार तो है अपनी जगह, बट अगर पर्सन वहां पे रह के अगर काम नहीं कर पाया और वी कैन से अपनी बात अगर लोगों तक नहीं पहचान पाया, बता पाया, या कम्युनिटी का अनमेट नीड की अंडरस्टैंडिंग नहीं हुई, तो कुछ भी नहीं हो पाएगा, कहने का मतलब है. तो वो एक बहुत जरूरी है कि पर्सन को टाइम देके कम्युनिटी के साथ रह के इन्वॉल्वमेंट बढ़ा के देन अपन उसको आगे बढ़ा सकते हैं. तो यस, ये थोड़ा थोड़ा इसको समय लगेगा और एक समय आएगा कि वहां तक के पहुंचेगा, कहने का मतलब है, क्योंकि इतने रिमोट एरिया में अभी थोड़ा थोड़ा स्टेप बाय स्टेप विकास हो रहा है, कहने का मतलब ये है.
Good, good. This was quite interesting and also, in fact, an eye-opener for me at least, that so many things which is probably relatively simple, staying in larger cities, can become difficult when you have a startup, social startup coming in from rural area, coming in from villages, coming in from remote corners of the country. And I must congratulate you for the work that you are doing even in the remotest part of the country. So that I'll move to Rohit Bhayana. So Rohit, you have seen and you have invested in multiple startups. So do you think that having a POC, it increases the chance and the scope of startups succeeding? What's your view from your experience in all the startups that you have invested in?
I think a POC is a necessary thing, not a sufficient thing. So there are, and I know this is quite commonsensical, but there's so many things that get fit into the whole puzzle to get the whole thing together. But the POC is a very critical one. I'm trying to just think a little counterintuitive. I think why the reason I'm saying this is there's so many pieces of the puzzle is how you define the POC can be a big thing, because it's a vibe, it's a very critical and a necessary part of making a company successful, making a venture successful. The way you define a POC can be the difference between successful interpretations and not so successful interpretations. At the end of the day, I think a POC is all about interpretations one is making, you're making, your customers are making, your employees are making, your investors are making. So if you really, really ask me, Devroop, at the bottom of the whole equation, what is a POC doing? It is clearing interpretations. It is taking the fog out of many interpretations. So therefore, if you're getting into interpretations in the beginning, you're creating a hypothesis saying, okay, acha, agar ye POC successful hoga, to A, B, C prove hoga. You need to be very clear with what is that A, B, C, and why is this POC necessary for the A, B, C? The reason I'm pointing this out is lots of POCs have started with point A and ended at point B, and one ends up defining it as a success, but it wasn't a success because B was better than A. It was a success because either B became a sharper problem solved, or B became a more economic way to do it, or a less frictionful environment to solve it. There are all those things that come in. But to start with, a great team or a great POC is one which will very tightly say, what am I proving with this? Who am I proving it to? And what is that validation going to take me to the next part of the puzzle to solve? So unless and until that happens, and you just go into a POC saying, okay, you know what, I'm going to do product market fit. Product market fit is a far bigger thing. I think several people in this call have said, POC is one, it's many of those steps which are going into that equation. And therefore, one should neither over-imagine the importance of a POC, that if a POC is successful, the business is going to be successful, everything comes together. But it's a very necessary part of it.
Sure. Thanks, Rohit. So I'll go to Dr. Dayananda Methi. Dr. Methi, as a startup, so what sort of support would you look forward to from the industry and from the investor community in driving POCs for startup? and especially focusing on the Northeast region as well. So Dr. Mehti.
Yeah, so thank you for the question. And for the especially for the Northeast, so we need to understand and we need to more aware about what importance of the PO, I mean the proof of concept. And we need to, if possible here in Northeast, still we are still lagging of the incubators, accelerators, and we have the still ecosystem is in the still in the budding stage. So even not a physical incubator also, if possible like a virtual incubator and webinars and seminars about how to make a POC and how to make a startup, a validation of a startup, how to see whether this is acceptable by the customers or it's a viable economically. So I sort of the incubators, we need incubators, physical incubator as well as virtual, and a lot of seminar, webinar, and regarding about. And more important thing about North is that most of the startup from North is including ourselves. We are so regional centric. We are mostly in the state centric. So we need to broaden our mindset as an entrepreneur. We need to tell that the market is big. And because here, even from I'm from Manipur, most of the startup in Manipur, say from Assam, from Meghalaya, from Nagaland, they just want to be the largest in their state. When they're not focusing for the like the big dream. So this kind of sort of thing, we need to give an examples. So this is what we need from especially from Northeast.
Sure. Thanks, Dr. Mehti. So I'll come to Neelam Dhawan. So Neelam, how can POCs be accelerated? How can it be fast tracked so that startups can quickly demonstrate the need and viability of an idea? So from your experience, what are your views on this?
Devru, POCs, especially tech POCs, they keep on getting extended. If there are 100 functionalities, the client may want to see all of them before he decides. So it is important to first have a conversation, what will we show in the POC and define the scope of the POC. Otherwise, we will be in proof of concept for very long, that stage. So getting a sign off, we will show you this working. And then you hopefully you'll give us the order or agree to pay for the balance which we are doing. I know it's a very tough task to ask them to pay, but limiting to what we will show as scope of work before the POC starts is a very important thing to do. The second thing is select the industry or the domain in which you're going to show. For example, if you're doing a first POC in an automotive sector, so second bhi wahi karo, third also in another company, the learning of the first automotive company to the second to the third makes it easier and less time consuming for you to do. To say I will do an AI project in automotive, I'll do one in banking, I'll do one in telecom, I think that is not the way to do, because each POC is not getting repeated or replicable. So it is good to select a area and then say I'll do first in these, get my first 2-3 customers in the same sector and then go to another sector, because every sector will ask for a POC to be done. And I think the problem statement also is we have a roadmap of our product, and this is I'm focusing on technology on this comment. We have a roadmap that today we have this product generation, version 2 will have these functionalities, version 3 will have these functionalities. We go and discuss it because we are doing an oversell of our product. But what happens is the client then says, let me wait for version 3 to come rather than this. So we have to focus on saying my product has these functionalities, right? And stay with what we can show and deliver today. Neither it becomes endless. Everything has to be shown again and again. So do not talk about, in my recommendation is, do not talk about what has not been built out already in your product or is not a feature in your product right now. Just focus on what is the deliverable, what are the features which have got developed and tested. That's what you first go and sell. And you know, if the customer says, and this is my last point on this issue, the customers turn around and say, can you do this? And very often to please the customer, we'll say yes. I think that's a mistake. We can say current product is this, and given your suggestion, if you go with me, I will build it for you. Do not say I will build right away. That again keeps on extending the POC. And you know, this battle on I must see the product, I must see 100% functionality before I give you 1 rupee of order has to stop. And that I feel is the battle which we can, by limiting the scope, by focusing on a sector, and by focusing on what we have already developed.
Sure. Thanks, Neelam. Very interesting points. So we have some more time. Probably what we'll do is we'll take one or two questions or thoughts from the audience. We have a large audience out here. So there's one point which has come in, and I'll request maybe 2-3 people from our distinguished panel of speakers to respond. So while Sachin spoke briefly about this, so there's a point which has come in is that many of good startup ideas, they die a natural death for lack of funds, and bootstrapping doesn't really meet the requirement of a POC. So how to go about, what are the options which are there? So maybe Rohit, to start off with, maybe if you can give your view, then probably Neelam, if you can come in and give your view.
You know, a lot of Devrup, a lot of the answer to this question lies in what Neelam just said. I think that viability, the POC funding, the whole thing actually becomes a challenge when people over imagine the size of the POC or over construct it. A very narrowly defined POC is legitimately supposed to be very viable. It's either viable because you can do it for zero cost to prove the point to the customer, or the cost is so low that the customer can very easily absorb it. Any small or large company struggles to take a POC charge on its head. Everyone has a pushback. Internally, you have several other possible competitors or other or alternates. So I think how narrowly and tightly you can define a POC makes it very viable. Also, one more point I would say is, again, this is linking back to Neelam. Actually, I was going to say this before this question came up, right after Neelam was done. I think POC, one must also be very clear where it is not a POC. There are times and situations where you're a little ahead of the need for a POC, and customers could be putting you into the square box of the POC thing. POC karo. It's not a POC at that stage, perhaps it's a pilot. And the difference between a POC and a pilot is as big as night and day. So I think it's very important for entrepreneurs to be clear, where are they at a stage of validation that it necessitates a POC, whereas where can they push back slightly and ask for a pilot and not a POC? But Neelam, over to you.
So I think, Rohit, you've said it all. I think meaningful POCs, limited amount of time has to be spent on it. Otherwise, it will become the first site. It will become a pilot, and unpaid pilots are plenty. And I think, you know, the question remains, how many POCs can we do before we get results? I remember we were working on a, of course, this is 7-8 years ago, no reflection of the situation today. I was working on some tax projects for the government, and every state would say, no, we have to see it again. And you can't keep on endlessly doing this. So defining, bringing it to a focus is very critical. And you know, POC is to give credibility. If we are a new company, we have developed a new product or technology, and we are showing it to you. So wo credibility build karne ke liye bahut zaruri hai. But also important is who's backing the startup, right? So the credibility of the company gets reflected by two stages. First is who is the founder, managers, who are the people behind this startup? Are they long-term players? Are they short-term players? Two, what have they developed? Is it bug free? Is it working? Is it free of defects? So that credibility also comes in at this stage. Now somebody may say, how long am I going to keep on showing? Sometimes until you get the first few orders, you have to do. Once you've got first few orders, then it is repeat in the same sector or in the same state, and then you can say X has done it, Y has done it, and hence you know, you don't have to do so much POC. So your credibility also comes when you get the customers using it. Then they say, huh, backed by XYZ, these are the good promoters. Technology is already working in some other company, so we can experiment with it or we can take it and do it. I found try and buy another very good concept to try out. We said, you give us an order, you try it. If you like what we are doing, then you pay us, right? And you buy the product. And in software, I've done it many times because I find if they try it, they like it, they'll buy it, but I must get an agreement. Yani try kar liya, thank you very much. Good idea, we'll look at you 6 months from now. Wo nahi hai. And that is something which is, you know, then even if you have to spend 2-3 lakhs, 5 lakhs doing it, it pinches you. Kuch order hi nahi hai, kuch business nahi hua. So it is best to do a try and buy agreement also. And most of the corporates, you know, even manufacturing companies understand this. And that's another way to do it. Yeah.
Sure. Thanks, Neelam. So we have another point saying that one of the panel members was talking of prior steps or what are the steps of a POC, like understanding the capabilities of the founders, etc. And if we can elaborate a bit on it. So maybe if we have Himanshu talk a bit about it, what are the steps in a POC, or like how do you go about understanding the capabilities of the founders and then drive the POC, etc.?
Firstly, in terms of capabilities, you really need to understand what is the product that you are trying to build, right? So if it's, let's say, assuming it's a product tech company or product tech startup, then you definitely need a technology team, like a full stack person or front end back end. Let's say if you are just starting with a web-based POC, right? Which makes sense, right? You don't need to have, let's say, your apps present on Android, iOS, everywhere, right? You can simply have a mobile web presence, right? And for that, you simply need a web developer, and at max, like, let's say you can even use third party platforms like WordPress, or could be, let's say, Shopify if it's an e-commerce platform that you're building, right? So a tech person, essentially a full stack tech person, is definitely a must. Second is somebody who is great with a product knowledge or a marketing knowledge, you know, especially product marketing, because for a POC, what you need is to sell that product out in the market. Now you need someone who can actually market it or understand at least the user segment and how to position your product, right? Because that becomes very important. And even if, let's say, I would say, like, given the, I've mentored more than like 20-25 startups, right? And the first POC is most likely going to be unsuccessful, or there'll be a lot of learnings. So you would need at least 2-3 such POCs to be done, which you can finally, or even more, right? More number of POCs you can finally take to investors. So having a team who has a very good sort of, or founding team who has a very good sort of determination towards the industry that you are starting with, or very acute focus, or at least believe in that industry, right? So that is there. And apart from that, yeah, I mean, overall, let's say people who you can really trust across various skill sets, like operations, speaking with customers, design is again like one important element, right? So UI, UX design again becomes an important element. And some of these actually can easily be outsourced too. So honestly, I mean, a lot of times we suggest and tell our, you know, like the founders that you either get this person full-time on board. If you don't have, let's say, so much capital with you, then quickly outsource it for a month or on a project basis, right? And even use platforms like Fiverr and all, where you can get freelancers. So I think these are some of the ways in which founders can quickly think of doing POCs in a very capital efficient manner.
Sure, thanks. So another question that we have, and probably maybe Sachin, you can come in, is what are the channels or what are the means by which one can deliver a POC to a customer or to a client?
It actually depends on, you know, what product are you offering to the market, or what solution have you developed. It is very difficult to identify a channel till the time you understand the product, because customers can be individual consumers, it can be enterprises, it can be startups, it can be SMEs, it can be, so depending upon what you have developed, you need to have a go-to-market kind of a strategy broadly in place, or at least the broad thinking in place, and then accordingly go back to those customers for doing a POC. This is actually your you know, your initial set of a customers of a sort, which you think will be the potential buyers for this. And that is how you start with those customers to do a POC. You know, there is no right or wrong answer. You, as a founder, you need to be clear whom you are offering this product.
Sure. Thanks, Sachin. So we had a very interesting, very fruitful discussion. We had views from government, from industry, from the academia. With this, I'll request Ms. Neelam Dhawan, co-chairperson, ASSOCHAM Startup Council, for her closing remarks. Over to you, Neelam.
Thank you, Devroop. Thank you. As you rightly mentioned, we had a very good conversation. All the stakeholders, whether you're a startup, whether it's government, whether it's investors, and whether you're academia, we looked at all the points of view, and I think we all made suggestions and recommendations which can help many of the startups be successful as they go in through their journey of launching their product and services. I know it's a pain point because this was discussed, as Rohit mentioned, when we took feedback from all the startups, what are the few pain points which we should address in our sessions. But I think you, all of you, would have got some good ideas on how you can restrict these POC conversations, how you can do successful POCs, and how you can start your business very well. Thank you, everyone, for being on the call, and special thanks to you, Devroop, for doing this session for us. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks, everyone.